Sort of recognize this, but I can't place it. Is it a dual thing?
Well, I'm going to show it to you in a second.
Ah. I did a lot of stuff with Bill Cudliffe, too.
Here we are.
Oh, yeah. Oh. Thank you.
Yeah, that was really good. Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, this is my guest today, the revered Mike Wofford.
Oh, all right.
Did I say your name well?
You know, I always tell my younger players, younger pianists that want tips or whatever, that it's really important to not overplay and not play a million things necessarily to build a solo, and I broke all my own rules on that last.
Well, you know, sometimes you have to do it, you know.
Yeah.
It just happens like that. Sorry, I'm just getting my stuff together here. Technology, Mike.
Mm-hmm.
Mike, did you used to come up to LA more, like in the old days, like in the 80s?
Well, yeah, you know, I grew up in San Diego. I was born in Texas.
Yeah.
I don't like to repeat that too much, but I really grew up and went all through school in San Diego. And then when I got out of school, I had been going to the Lighthouse, you know.
Oh, right.
I was still in high school. Yeah. I was underage, but I knew Howard. So
yeah,
it was all Howard Rumsey. But
yeah,
I used to love to go up there. And of course, Bud Schenk and Conti and one of my favorite piano player, Sonny Clark, and yeah. I sit next to Sonny and just marvel at his playing. And I was, you know, I was, as I said, I was too young to really be in the place, but I got away with it. And so I started coming to LA more then, not just go to the Lighthouse, but I remember Jazz City and some of the other clubs at that time, you know. But I really took up residence in LA in the early about 63, something like that. And I stayed there really until about mid 70s, about 1974 or 5, I moved back to San Diego. And so I was actually an Angelino for quite a few years.
Yeah.
Working with all those great people at that time, you know, just incredible people, the Shelley Mann. And
yeah, I know that was a really big chunk of your life. Yeah. I mean, real solid chunk.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So Howard Rumsey, were you kind of ensconced in the Lighthouse and playing with them too?
Well, I just went as a patron, you know.
Oh, okay.
Whenever I would drive up, by that time I had my own car, and I would drive up.
Oh boy, man, you were young.
There were some other guys that went on to be wonderful players. You may know their names. Don Sleet was a wonderful trumpet player who passed way too young. Gary Lefebvre, a wonderful saxophone.
Oh.
Johnny Guerin, I'm sure you're aware of Johnny. You're
a great drummer, yeah.
Great drummers ever.
Yeah.
And so we were all just kids, and we would drive up there, you know, for the Sunday session. That Sunday session at the Lighthouse went on forever. Wow. And I thought about it years later. I don't know how the house band, you know, Count and Bud Schenk and Frank Rosalino, I don't know how they did it. It was like about 12 or 14 hour day that they put in. You know, it started, it would start in mid-morning on a Sunday, and it would go till closing.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. So it's amazing looking back now, but the club actually went about six nights a week, but Sunday was the big day because that was all day.
God, I wonder who thought of that, and it just makes me wonder how it felt to be in the house band hanging out all day long.
Yeah,
I mean, I'm sure they weren't playing all the time, right? Everybody was kind of coming in and playing, but like I told you, I went to this jam last night with a bunch of lots of what I think are probably students hanging out, you know, like college students, and the teachers were actually the house band, really great players. I don't know if you know a pianist named Gary Fukushima.
No, I don't know that name.
He's wonderful, and a bass player, Lyman Medeiros, and the drummer, her name just escaped me, went right out of my head, Tina Raymond.
Oh.
What a great drummer she is. Wow, what a great feel. Anyway, so they're all teachers at Cal State Northridge, and I think a lot of their students were in, and sounded good, you know, mm-hmm. really. I mean, and everybody was really excited and crowded in. Now, the lighthouse actually was kind of a little bit roomy, you know. You could probably spread out a little. I loved how the lighthouse was set up.
Oh, yeah.
That was such a cool room.
Yeah, those were great, great times. I fondly remember, you know. And I actually got to sit in a few times when I was still just coming in as a customer, you know. But I got to know Howard, and a couple of times he'd have me sit in with the band. I had no business there, really, probably. I did, anyway. And but then later on, sometime around the early 60s, I had moved to LA, and I actually worked. I was in the Lighthouse band for about a month. And at that time, it was Bob Cooper and great, you know, great.
Yeah, Bob Cooper.
Yeah, one of the sweethearts.
Sweetheart and a great, unbelievable player. Really, one of the kings, I think. You know,
he really was. He was a marvelous, marvelous improviser and player, and just a super guy.
Yeah,
Coop.
Yeah, Coop. Well, and for that matter, when I was first in LA and I was very young, and I got a job waitressing at Dante's.
Oh.
So I was there for about a year and a half, and that's where, you know, I really met a lot of, you know, of the community, you know. And and the Condoli brothers actually were, they, this is the impression of a young waitress. So they were really kind. They always got Courvoisier and stuff like that, and then they always tipped me great, and they were extremely sweet and kind to me.
Yeah. Well, the Condolis were great. And Conti was one of my favorite people ever.
Yeah.
Count.
Really nice. I'll always feel
one of the truly great, great trumpet players. He, you know, he went on to do more studio work later, and his name really wasn't out there as much in the jazz circles, but people who know jazz trumpet all know who Count was. His brother was not really an improviser. He was a big band player. But he was a great, like, lead trumpet and that sort of
thing. Yeah, yeah.
But, yeah.
Well, also those days, Frank Rossellino was at Dante's a lot then, you know, and I was around for his unfortunate demise. And, but he was, boy, I just thought his playing was exquisite.
It was. Yeah, it truly was. He was a one-off. You could tell the truly great players, of course, you can tell on a recording within three or four bars who it is. You know, that's a real compliment to truly great players, you know, whether it's Miles or whoever you're talking about.
You
know immediately who they are.
Yeah.
And Frank was one of those people. You know, I could tell Frank in two bars, I think.
Yeah.
One of the funniest guys ever, and everybody, when he died, as he did, nobody could believe it. It was the same guy that had done it, because he was just always the life of the party and cutting up and funny. And I remember at the time, Roger Kellaway, the great pianist up there, said, you know, we should have known something was wrong, because nobody kids around all the time like that.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, Roger.
I guess he was manic, but I mean, we didn't really talk about that kind of stuff then, you know.
Yeah, I don't think so. That's probably a good description of Mike. He was. By the way, it was Rosalino, according to Howard Rumsey. He always told me it should be Rosalino, but everybody said Rosalino. You know. I'll just throw that in.
Yeah, he was really, and of course. His singing was definitely unique. That was great, man. He was a really great artist.
Oh yeah. You're Frank.
Frank, yeah. Yeah, he was really nice. He could
play the highest, he didn't do it all the time, but he could play the highest register of the trombone flawlessly on up tempos and, you know, just the technique that he had was incredible, and the facility and the sound, and yeah, amazing guy.
You know, I think for me, it was a combination of the feeling of that kind of person and the music that drew me into jazz. You know, not just the music, but the feeling of the relaxed viewpoint of life that takes everything in and everything into consideration, and everything is copacetic, you know. I think that's really what, you know, because my dad was a sax player and I used to go to rehearsals. And when I was like, you know, four, you know, and of course the musicians would kind of flirt with me, you know. And I just thought, I thought that was the greatest thing. Yeah. In the world, you know.
Of course. Yeah, jazz musicians are a wonderful lot.
Yeah. So you played with Shelly Mann, right? Mm-hmm. For Shelly a long Mann. Time too.
Shelly Mann and his men. That was this was some years later, after I'd already moved to LA, as I said, and started just gigging around town. And Russ Freeman had been his longtime pianist, wonderful pianist.
Yeah.
And another just wonderful guy, Russ. But he'd gotten a really good offer to go on the road as an accompanist with a singer. I'm drawing a blank right now. It was a good singer.
Yeah.
And so that chair was open with Shelley's band. Russ had done it forever, you know, since the inception of that band. But Shelley called me one day and said, would I like to join him? And boy, I couldn't wait.
Oh, that's cool. And you were there like 6 or 7 years or more?
Yeah, probably about that.
Yeah. Who was in the band? Do you remember?
It was Conti Condoli and Frank Strozier, a wonderful alto player from New York. He had come up from New York to resettle in L.A., and he was out here for a few years, and then he decided to go back east again. So I didn't hear much about him after that, but he was a wonderful player and another really unique sounding player. He had his own thing, his sound and his ideas and his time field, everything. He was one of the special guys.
Who was on bass?
Monty Budwig.
Oh.
And sometimes there would be other bass players from time to time, but it was Monty's chair, you know. And
another great guy.
Yeah.
And his wife was really.
I'm trying to think who the the other horn player was when I, oh, it was Frank, Frank Strozer, I mentioned.
Yeah, yeah. What was it like playing with Shelley?
Oh, a dream.
It was.
Just a dream, yeah. The time, the ideas, the technique, but never too much, you know, everything. Just a remarkable, remarkable drummer. And just so great to play with, very, never trying to show anyone up or stand out. You know, he was a great, wonderful brushes player. You know, he could do that like crazy. Yeah, Shelley, and just a wonderful guy. You know, he helped a lot of musicians when they were down and out and needed help. And he and Flip, you know, his wife, Flip, wonderful, who is still with us.
Yeah, she just turned 100.
I know, I can't
believe it. I was at her little party.
Did you? Oh, yeah. I spoke to her on the phone just a few weeks ago, and I kept threatening to come up from San Diego to spend some time with her, but at that time, the epidemic was so bad that they really didn't want people coming into the rest home where she was living. So yep. I didn't get to see her at the end, but she was wonderful. And yeah.
Do you know that she just recently, well, like 2 years ago, stopped tap dancing?
Yeah, yeah. In fact, the last time I saw her a few months ago, actually in person, I did see her. At her home, I took her out for lunch one day, and she was still going to tap once or twice. And I think president of the Jazz Wives, what is the official title of that group?
Yeah, I don't know the official title, but yeah, that's.
I think she was president for a long time.
Yeah, I think so.
Wonderful.
She's awfully cute. I really like her. She's really cool. She's kind of like Lynn Wiggins, you know.
I know, I've met Lynn, yeah, I don't know her well, but I remember meeting her.
Yeah, I have to make a note to go see Lynn Wiggins, because yeah. I love Lynn Wiggins, man. She's a really cool person, really cool.
Her husband was a heck of a pianist player, too.
I know, Wiggs was like,
yeah,
he was, talk about an elegant player, you know, with these beautiful ideas. Wow.
Yeah. Elegance is a very good description.
Yeah. His son, I don't know if you know his son, he's a really great bass player. He doesn't live here. I think he lives on the East Coast, but from time to time he'll come here, and mm-hmm. he's really swinging and great, great player.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so, and Shelley, did Shelley have the manhole at that time?
Oh, yeah.
Or
it had only been up and running for, I think, a year and a half or 2 years when I joined.
Hmm.
And then I used to work there before I joined Shelley's band. I actually had already worked some nights here and there in the club with Bud Shank. He had, I think, a Tuesday night regular gig or something like that. And Jack Sheldon I worked with a little bit. I mean, I was just a new young kid in town. I couldn't believe how the good fortune I kept falling into, you know, just playing with these great people that I'd idolized. I had all their albums when I was a kid, you know. And, somehow things just kind of went that way, and I got a little more, you know, exposure to playing with really great players. And boy,
did you just keep getting referred, basically?
Yeah, well, you know, that's the way it works in our business. Word of mouth, and people hear about you, and the more you're out playing, the more, if people like your playing and like to play with you, then they put in a word. And you know, it's definitely a process.
It's so cool. It's talking to all these people. And ladies and gentlemen, if you didn't know this, Mike is my 300th guest, which is pretty wonderful. And
I'm expecting the gift. I don't know.
I know.
You're gonna
I have to think of a good gift. But
Cognac would work.
cognac, okay, what kind do you drink?
Oh, I don't really, but
Yeah, so let's see. I was gonna say, oh yeah, I was gonna say that it's so, for me personally, and also I know for people who listen, especially people who have listened over the last year consistently, it's so interesting to hear it. It seems like everybody had these kind of, I was there at the right moment, right? Because if you keep moving forward, you're always somewhere. And a bunch of people are moving forward and your paths cross and you're there at the right moment. But it's just so interesting, the stories. Like for instance, David Amram,
Oh, yeah. I met
he
him
was,
3 years ago.
yeah, he said he was just sitting around with was it Charlie Parker and Mingus came in. They were in a club and Charlie said, oh, you should use this guy. He's really an amazing French horn player, jazz. And Mingus did. He actually, right there, he said, do you want to come on the road with me to Europe?
Yeah, David was around a lot back at that time, playing a lot, yeah.
Yeah. That's so cool. I mean, sometimes I think people think that the instruments like that have kind of come into jazz recently, but no. French horn was in bebop.
Sure, yeah,
David
absolutely.
Amram's really cool. He was fun to talk with.
I'll bet. Is he here
Yeah.
in the States? Because
He's
he's
in
been
New
all
York.
at different times, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, he lives in New York, and gosh, I mean, at the time I talked to him, which was, maybe I don't know how long ago, 6 months ago or something, he had 12 projects going on.
Wow.
Yeah, I think he had just turned 92. Yeah,
Well, he's.
very creative person. He was writing a book, or he had just come out with a book, and I forget of who, but it was Joyce. Tell me who could this woman Joyce Glasgow is listening. You might know Joyce Glasgow. She's a big fan and an artist in Seattle. She knows everybody, and she probably knows Bud Shank and been in the audience maybe when you've been playing. Did you teach at Bud Shank's summer camp,
No, I
Jeff?
never did. I never did. I've never done any teaching, organized, serious teaching. I just didn't, not that I don't, I mean, I appreciate people who do and who do it well,
Yeah.
I just was never drawn to toward it.
Yeah.
But that's a wonderful thing he did. He had one of the, I guess, one of the very first of the jazz camps. Now they're fairly, ubiquitous around the country.
Yeah, definitely.
That was very rare in its day. That was at what, Port Townsend,
Yeah.
Washington,
Yeah.
and Bud was a great guy. He was another one who really helped me break in when I moved to LA from San Diego. He was one of the first people. He said, "When you get in town, give me a call." I had met him somewhere, and sure enough, as soon as I got an apartment in LA, I called him. He called me to do a night at Shelley's with him on the off nights, and wonderful player, alto and flute, wonderful flutist too.
Great player, yeah, really great player.
Lot over the years after that in Europe, and yeah, a lot.
Yeah. Sorry, there was a bluesette. Who are you, bluesette? I'm talking to my chatting people. He said, yeah, thanks for reminding me, bluesette. David Amram professes hangoutology.
Hanging out holiday.
Yeah, that's what he calls it, hangoutology. Hanging out is a good way to learn and meet mentors. And the book that he was friends with him, he talked about, I think he talked about his relationship with Kerouac.
Oh,
So he has this book that for a while he was actually reciting on Facebook or on Zoom.
David, this is David you're talking about.
David, yeah.
So, you know, that rings a bell because I remember the guys talking about him when I was first up in L.A. I may have briefly met him. If so, it was just really in passing. And we never worked together. But I used to hear about all these things he was involved in. The celebrities that he moved with, you know, and it doesn't surprise me at all. You said he was a writer. And
yeah.
He was a man of many facets, I think.
Definitely. He sings he'll play piano and sing. And I saw one video of him with a group of relatively young musicians in performance, and he was very entertaining, singing and playing piano. And it was kind of Americana type of music. Yeah. It's really interesting. Yeah, pretty cool guy. So of course, I'd like to play a little bit of Spotify because I found some wonderful, wonderful songs, and I'm going to share the screen. I'd like to talk about some of your writing, and it's probably in. Is there any of your originals in here?
Let me see. In that list. Not in that batch. No. That's all from the same album. That's not. It's personal.
Oh, it's not?
Or is it? Yes, it is. You're right. It is. And no, I don't have an original in there.
All right. And then how about in Time Cafe?
Time Cafe, I do.
Nice band, Derek and Duncan.
Yes, it is. You know, I may have spoken too soon. I don't think I have an original in that batch either. It's a few years ago.
All right. What about Synergy?
Synergy. JP's Afternoon.
Okay.
That was named after my grandson at the time. JP's Afternoon. And Cole Porter.
Oh.
The name of the song is Cole Porter.
Cool.
Yeah, those are the two.
Well, let's listen.
Quietsville.
Okay, let's listen at least.
Let's start. Derek, as you mentioned, on bass, one of the truly great, great bass players.
Really great.
And you know, I didn't realize, someone pointed, in fact, I think it was maybe my wife, Holly, that pointed out that he has perfect pitch. And he is about the most in tune bassist you will ever hear or play with.
And that's interesting.
I don't know where she got that information. Maybe he had even mentioned it, but his intonation is, you know, impeccable. And apparently he has that kind of hearing, you know.
I can believe it. Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting, especially I've sung with bass here and there, you know, bass only. And sometimes it's challenging because of intonation, you know, and it's not that they have bad intonation. It's just that they might lean a little towards the lower part of the note and I might lean towards the upper or whatever, vice versa. But yeah, bass is, it's interesting. Bass is quite an interesting instrument.
You know, I always loved was, and everybody did, was Albert Stinson. Do you remember Albert Stinson?
Yes.
Sparky was his nickname.
What was his nickname?
Sparky.
Oh, Sparky.
He left us very early, unfortunately, but boy, he was wonderful. Anyway, I digress, but I just, bass players, he popped to mind.
I digress. My husband always says that. Yeah. Okay.
You know you're in trouble. So.
Here's JP's Afternoon. So we're going to listen.
Okay.
Wow, that's very beautiful.
Of
You're
course,
playing.
it sounds like a little 4-year-old running around at the park. That's
Well,
what.
you know what's funny is that I wrote a song for my niece who was 8 at the time. I wrote it coming home on the plane, and it's kind of monk-like, and it's kind of like yours. I was listening and I was like, wow, that's a lot like my little song, you know, my song for Sandy. But what a beautiful song, really beautiful. You know what, some,
That's the great Joe LaBarbera on drums, you know.
oh, I was wondering, yeah.
Something else. And a young bass player from the San Diego area, Rob Thorson.
Oh.
They sound wonderful on this.
Just great, actually. The just really beautiful. And you know, you're playing. You know what? Now this sounds kind of a little bit stupid, I think. So excuse me. But from my point of view, when I listen to a lot of people who have gotten more into studio stuff over the years, which is what you have done. And then I hear they're playing, it sounds a little rusty, let's say, or a little less developed as a jazz player, right? But you're playing on everything I've heard, doesn't sound like that at all. It sounds like you've been playing jazz for like all these years.
Well, I have. I mean, I fell in love with it when I was still in high school, and so since my teens, I loved it. And of course, Art Tatum was one of the first people that knocked me out. And but there, I mean, that's a nice, very high compliment you paid me. I appreciate that. That it doesn't sound like. I did work in the studios. I fell into just really by accident into Hollywood studio work, motion pictures and TV shows and stuff. And I did a lot of that for years. So, but I was always out playing as well. You mentioned Dante's. I used to work there with Mike Brown's big band every,
Oh.
I think that was Wednesday nights. We did that for several years at least. And, so I was still active and playing. I wasn't just buried in the studios, but that could become a problem. I know guys that there was so much work there, and the money was so good that it was hard not to fall into it, hard to turn it down.
Yeah,
That's
absolutely.
a that's kind of a that's all been changed by the technology now and synthesizers and electronic music, and there's not nearly the work there once was. But they used to do major motion pictures, with huge orchestras, strings, everybody.
Yeah.
And I used to work at Universal and doing a lot of that stuff. Anyway, it's kind of a it's changed. Everything changes in life. It's just.
I think I was a waitress at Dante's when the change was starting to happen. I was there 75 to 77.
That's when
So,
I left, so yeah.
yeah. And I think that's when the change started happening. I remember this one guy whose name I won't remember because I'm having trouble remembering names now, but he was
You too,
a
huh?
big, huh?
You too, huh?
Yeah, a big arranger. He might have been a horn player originally. Anyway, he would come into Dante's and he would buy champagne for everybody. So he was doing well. And
A
but right
contractor.
around
It
that,
sounded like it was a contractor, maybe. You know what they used to.
yeah, he was. But he was a contractor. But he was an arranger too. I think maybe he was. Oh God, his name is on the tip of my tongue. But. Anyway, but I think around that time I started hearing that the scene was changing. You know, it was getting less live and more. You know, the synthesizers were coming in and.
Well, again, when I first started doing studio work in Hollywood, especially on big pictures and that sort of thing,
Yeah.
there would literally, I would walk in sometimes, it'd be an orchestra of like 40, 50 people, you know, in one of the big sound stages. And that all just kind of died. And one guy in his garage with the technology could score a major picture and not have to pay 40 or 50 other people and copyists and all the other expenses, you know, that go into that. So, but of course things do change in every generation, you know, whether it's music or whatever. But it's a shame. I wish that weren't the case, because there's a lot of wonderful music produced, and not that there isn't now, but it's less.
I can imagine it must have been an incredibly fabulous feeling and experience to go in and have this full orchestra in a beautiful soundstage playing.
Well, nerve-wracking too, because you'd open up your music for the afternoon or whatever that you were going to read for the first time, and it could be spine-tinglingly rough. You had to have nerves of steel. I used to work next to a legendary pianist, Artie Kane. Do you remember that name?
I remember that name.
He was ridiculous. He could read anything.
What did he play?
Piano.
Oh, okay.
And he would be the primary pianist on a big picture, say a Paramount or Fox. A lot of times I'd be playing piano and also keyboards. I started playing a lot of B3 organ and different things on, just not live as a jazz career, but just to work
on the studio. Yeah. Uh-huh.
And Artie Kane, anyway, he was world famous as just nerves of steel and could read anything. And yeah, I don't know why that name came to mind, but he was incredible, and he was a great guy.
It comes to mind that Mike Lang must be like that.
Mike was. We used to do a lot of those calls together. We'd be sitting next to one another when they needed more than just one keyboard. You know, if they needed two or three, and Mike was. Mike's a few years younger than me. But he was very accomplished. And I know he's gone on to be one of the cats now. You know, he has been for some time. I think Mike Melvoin was another one, a wonderful guy, Mike Melvoin. Anyway.
Oh, yeah, Mike Melvoin, woo, yeah. Yeah, we're a couple of, yeah, beautiful. It's kind of an embarrassment of riches. Yeah, Mike Lang, I remember, I've known him for years, and he would always say to me, I'd say, hey, sit in. He'd say, you know, I don't know anything, you know. Well, of course he did, but he was all, I mean, you put anything in front of him and he makes it sound incredible immediately.
I can believe that.
Yeah, which is definitely a skill and an art. Another person who I recorded with who was like that was Ross Tompkins.
Yeah, I never knew Ross really well. I knew him. I met him, you know, but I didn't. We didn't live in the same musical areas, I guess.
Yeah, he was an interesting man.
He did the Tonight Show, you know, for years and years.
Yeah.
Doc Severns.
Yeah, he was interesting. He was the person. His personality was very, he was the quiet, observant type. You know what I mean? Yeah. Strangely enough, he used to hang out with Marty Harris, which was the weirdest combination of people, because Marty Harris was brazen and out there, you know, and Ross was kind of very contained, you know. Oh my God. And Ross's wife and I were very dear friends, and yeah, I recorded a duo with him, which, you know, was amazing. He was just such an incredible accompanist. Just
Ross was.
Yeah.
No, he was a great player too. Yeah.
Yeah. Just yeah. He He was interesting. He used to go in, you know, he made a lot of solo records for this one producer, and he would go in for an hour to the studio, and that was the record. He just played through the songs. And you know, he didn't own a piano in his house.
I did not know that, but yeah.
It's kind of funny.
Yeah.
I always thought that was like interesting. It was like, wow, okay, well, whatever. I mean, he certainly went out and sat around, you know, sat in at places in LA, but I just thought that was kind of interesting, you know. You know, another great accompanist who you probably knew was Tom Garvin.
Oh yeah, I knew Tom very well, and he was a wonderful player, yeah,
Yeah, he was
and accompanist, wonderful accompanist.
kind of a stunning one of those guys, like you're singing and you're stunned by his musical, you know, support there. It's just like, whoa, you know, really incredible. Very nice. And speaking of accompaniment, I mean, you know, you couldn't get more kudos than you accompanying Sarah Vaughan and Ella Fitzgerald for a number of years. We have to
Yeah,
talk about that, of course.
Irene Kroll, I
Oh,
will
really?
well, yeah.
Oh, how long were you with Irene?
Well, we did. We never toured together. At least she, primarily, we would just play club dates. You know, she never had a career in the sense of a big touring star. You know, like Sass and Ella did. But Irene, one of the all-time greats ever. I'm sure you agree.
Oh, yeah. I have a story about her for you.
Oh.
First of all, I never heard Irene until I came to LA. I had grown up listening to Ella pretty much, and
Well, if you weren't in this
Rosemary.
area, you probably wouldn't have known who
Yeah, well, anyway, it ended up that
was
people would
Roy's
always.
sister, basically.
Yeah.
That's, you know.
Well, it ended up that people, like many times, would say that I had a tone like hers, which was interesting because it was like, well, okay, it was great, thank you, you know. And but this one time, I was working as a waitress in Dante's, and she and Alan Broadbent had a duo,
That's right. Yeah, for quite a
and
while.
and I didn't realize it, but it was probably. It could have been the last gig that she did. She had cancer, and that was the first time I heard Some Other Time. And when I found out she was dying, you know, I mean, you can imagine that affected me pretty heavily. And you know who the only two people in the audience were? It was one of those nights, you know, nobody was in the audience except Sarah Vaughan and Carmen McRae.
Sarah and Carmen were kind of running buddies. They used to work.
And I was their
Well,
waitress.
yeah, that's a real compliment to Irene.
Wasn't it amazing? Yeah. So anyway, that's my story of that. But
Wonderful story,
so yeah, you played for Irene. That's really beautiful. So and then so Sarah came first, kind of in the big singer lineage, or
Yeah,
the.
I worked with Sass for a couple of years, not back to back. I did a year, and Roy McCurdy, who's been a guest on your series, Roy is the drummer, and one of the wonderful guys and bass players, Andy Simpkins. Oh man, that was something else. Yeah.
Oh boy.
So he and Roy, I mean, that was for me to join that trio was a lot to deal with.
Wow.
So anyway, I did that for about a year, and then I left to do some other stuff, and then I went back for a second year, not too long after. And so I actually worked with her, you know, 2 years, but not consecutively. But she was wonderful to work for. Boy, what a dream to accompany. She heard everything, and you know, like a great horn player, you know, and just a wonderful woman. She Sass was something else. And then later on, I toured quite a bit with Ella for about 4 years. That was with Peter Betts and various drummers at different times. I actually got John Guerin on it at one time for a few things. So, but
she was probably very sweet, right, Ella?
Ella was, yeah. She was. I'll tell you an interesting little anecdote I've thought about over the years. I think it'll be interesting to you. When I first joined her, the very first time, there were 4 years that I did it, but just really, I'd only been with her maybe a month, if that. And Peter was the bass player. And so we did a couple of concerts, and I was just, it was on the job training for me. And I was, of course, I adored her as everyone did all for years. I mean, I knew all about Ella Fitzgerald, but I was still not quite sure what I was even doing there. but she was great. But I noticed that on the first or second concert we did, she would kind of stop in the middle of something and look over at me and kind of give me a little bit of a glare, you know, a little something that just didn't feel right. And I thought, my God, what have I done? I mean, I know I didn't, I wasn't playing any clams or anything, you know, that would have. And I mentioned it to Keeter Betts, the bassist, who'd been with her forever. And Keeter, before he passed, was still with her, I mean, until she retired.
Wow.
And I've always thanked him for this moment. I said, Keeter, I don't know what's going on, but Ella's giving me funny looks about what I'm doing behind her. And he said, I'll tell you what it is in a minute, if you got a minute. And I said, what's it? He said, she grew up and she came up with the big bands. And she's used to hearing, she's always wanted to hear a big band behind her, you know, with brass figures and punches and, you know, big band stuff. And me, after working with Sass, I was playing bebop with her. You know, I didn't know any better.
Yeah.
I mean, I think I was playing well, and I was doing okay. But when Keeter explained that to me, it all made perfect sense. And I started from that moment on, you know, she liked what you call block chords, you know, at the piano, kind of big band stuff, you know, punchy stuff. And she didn't want to hear filigree or little technical things, you know. She really just wanted to hear a big band behind her. We occasionally did some hits with Basie's band and a few things with big bands, but most of the time it was a trio and her.
Yeah.
But Keeter Betts, I thanked him till his last days for making my life much better. I ended up staying for 4 years. But I, if he hadn't told me that, I think I probably would have gotten fired before long. You know, so that's kind of a long, drawn-out story, but I thought you might get a kick out of that.
That's great. Wow.
Ella was always great to work for. She was a sweetheart. And no, you know, everything was fine after that.
Yeah, that's so interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can really imagine how that would be. And as a singer, you know, working with different players, yes, I know how I feel. And yeah, there's certain things that, like, I'm not in love when a player plays the melody somewhere for me or play. I don't know why they're playing the melody. It's like, don't play the melody.
Doubling what you're doing. I mean, doubling the melody.
Well, or you know, I mean, my style is a little.
Are you improvising? You mean?
Well, I mean, or phrasing. You know, just you know, and I'm never quite sure. I mean, of course, there's those times too. At the end of a song, when I'll pick some tension note to end on, and they'll try and correct me. It's like, don't correct me. I know what I'm singing. Yeah. I know what I want to hear, you know?
Yeah, I wasn't sure what you meant at first, but I see what you mean. That would not be something I'd want to hear if I were trying to sing and somebody playing the melody for me in the back, unless it's part of an arrangement or something.
Exactly. And sometimes, I mean, sometimes I can understand how a pianist might occasionally play the melody in the comping that they're playing. Sure. I can see that. That's okay. But you know, if they're just kind of unconsciously playing the melody and I'm singing, you know, that's like, I feel like slapping their hands.
Well, that's a sensitive area, the right accompaniments for any vocalist.
Yeah.
And sometimes, and often less is more with the accompanist is concerned. And that's not everybody knows that either sometimes when they're accompanying.
Yeah, it's such an interesting art form.
You know who was great was Jimmy Rolls.
Oh, yeah.
Rolls was something else. Of playing generally and then
his accompaniment. You know. Yeah.
I used to say, I work with Sarah and Ella, and Jimmy had worked with Sarah, Ella, and Billie Holiday.
Yeah.
Well, I was one short of the trifecta.
Yeah.
I love Jimmy.
Yeah, he was amazing. Lizard.
Did you ever hear that?
Say what?
Lizard.
Oh, no.
It's Lizard, yeah. Boy, what a player. And a great solo pianist and everything.
I remember speaking to him once about, much later in his life, about that recording that had surfaced with him and Billy in the studio. And which he wasn't getting compensated for, which was kind of a thorn in his side. But it was just a studio date, and she was talking, and she sounded like she was totally stoned, basically. But then she would sing, and it was perfect.
Mm-hmm. You know, if it's the same one that I've heard, there were a couple of them, and I think they were done in somebody's living room or something like that.
Oh,
if they're the ones I'm thinking of, because it was definitely Jimmy. Somebody I knew had those.
Yeah,
something similar to what you're saying. It may not be exactly the same, but it was them rehearsing.
And, yeah,
you know, Lady Day would say, you know, no, that's too fast. Let's change it. You know, or Jimmy would ask a question and kind of go back and forth. So it was kind of it was like a real rehearsal situation.
Yeah.
But she knew what she wanted. Boy, what a thrill that would be to
his daughter was so great too. You must have worked with his daughter, right, Stacy?
Stacy. Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah.
He was wonderful. What great player, great singer.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And a great person. I thought she passed on too young as well. Yeah. I was going to just talk a little bit about the art of accompanying, especially rubato, you know, which I think is worth tons of workshops, which I don't see enough of, I think. But I mean, that's just such an art form, you know, that really has to be developed and learned. And it's so rewarding, you know.
Some pianists fall into it very naturally, and others, and it can be a guitar as far as that's concerned sometimes, you know. But usually it would be piano with a vocalist. And some just, it's just second nature. They just know what's supposed to happen, you know. And others I can see where maybe they just wouldn't get it.
Yeah.
And of course every vocalist is different too, so you have to make your adjustments. I think really understanding the lyrics and thinking about lyrics can make a big difference too, rather than just playing stuff. Mm-hmm. I think it makes sense that you would be a more sensitive accompanist if you know what the song's about, obviously.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. I've been
pretty great singers that make it so easy, like Irene again. Irene was just, you know, you didn't have to even sweat anything, you know, it was just all right there.
Yeah. Did you ever happen to know Stephanie Haynes?
I know the name. I probably met her. I don't offhand. I don't.
She lived in LA for years. You know, after she grew up, she was a divine singer like that. I mean, just the, well, first of all, her tone was gorgeous, and she was such a natural. She, yeah, and I just thought you might have known her because she lived in the, she lived in Laguna for a long time, and she was just an amazing singer. I'll have to
name very well as soon as you said it, but I don't
worked with Ron Eshte a lot too.
Ron, yeah,
yeah, yeah. I should send you. I'm going to make a note to send you a little, you know, an MP3 of Steph because I think you'd enjoy. I bet Holly knows her.
She could very well, yeah. Possible. Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, speaking of Holly, so Holly Hoffman, the great flautist who we saw a little bit of with you before. When did you guys meet?
She came out, she was living in Denver, and then she grew up in Ohio, but she was went to school and all in Denver and was living there. And then she came to the coast to try to get her career going. And I think she was still in her 20s at that point. And so we just started working here in San Diego. We started working together, and then we would do a few things in LA too. You know, she started getting some calls to do in LA, and we just worked together for quite a few years, and eventually, yeah, we did get married, and we've been married 20 years now.
Oh, congratulations.
She's a wonderful woman. By the way, people will argue this to death, but it's flutist. It is not flautist.
I'm sorry. I do know that, but I'm used to saying flautist.
That's a European thing.
Flautist or flutist?
Flautist is a flute, you know.
You know, and I even play flute too. Yes.
Well, I just flashed on that when you were saying it.
Thank you for saying that. I've been told that before, and for some reason I always go back to flautist. But
I don't know what's wrong with that. It's perfectly legitimate, but there's something about it. It sounds affected or something. I don't know. Anyway, I always correct anyone if we're all, a lot of times when she's being introduced or being written about in an article or something, they insist on saying flautist. So
yeah,
I'm kind of a killjoy there.
Well, thank you for pointing that out, though. Yeah. So yeah, so 20 years, that's not actually that long. I mean, that's my husband and I have been married 20 years. Yeah. So that's not that long, but you knew each other and played together for a long time.
22 years. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's we knew nice. Each other and worked together for, I guess 6 or 7 years before that, probably.
Yeah. She's a wonderful player.
She's a one-off jazz flutist. I mean, I know I'm partial, of course, but she's the real deal.
Yeah.
She toured at one point with Ray Brown. He took her to Europe and with his band, and you know, the musicians have always respected her tremendously. She just for the general public, not a huge name, you know. But
yeah, I'm going to have to interview. I want to invite her hang out on this. Yeah, I guess San Diego has her and Lori Bell too, who's a really fine flutist as well.
Yeah. Lori's more of a classical player. It's really her forte. I mean, she does a lot of stuff, Latin stuff and, you know, different things, but she's really an accomplished classical player too.
Yeah. I saw that you had a Maybach video up too. What What was that about your Maybach? Did they invite you to do that, or do you? How did that come about?
Yeah, I'm trying. Maybe you'll come up with it. I can't come up with the.
Do you want me to?
The guy that produced those was not a musician, but
the Maybach was. Let's see, where is it? Maybach. I'm just looking on the. Oh, well, now I can't find it. Oh, I know why, because it was on Spotify, actually. The Maybach Recital Series in 1992.
I have a copy of it somewhere. I could, if you want to take a second, I could try it. The fellow who called me to do the Maybach has produced concerts in the Colorado area, I think. Jazz production. And he was particularly a piano guy. He really loved the piano players, and he did this series. I think I was like number 17 or 18 in the volumes, I think, that he did. He had just about every, Dave McKenna and all kinds of people on it. And so I think ultimately there were about 22 CDs that came out under the Maybach banner. Anyway, they were all done at a beautiful old home up in the Bay Area with great acoustics and a wonderful piano. And he did these concerts there, and he recorded everyone. And so I did one of them. Most of it I like. Some of it I just not. I'd like to have a redo on maybe, but I guess everybody feels that way. But I think most of it I'm really quite proud of.
We should listen to one actually. Here I'm going to bring it up. And here's I don't know what you like here.
But I know the one right away, number 4, Stablemates.
Okay, good. That was easy.
Thank you.
That's the great Benny Golson classic. I'm sure you know. You're
familiar. Yeah, I've never heard it played like that, though. I mean, it was really beautiful.
Beautiful song. I got to work with Benny quite a bit over the years. And great composer and saxophonist, everything, Benny.
Yeah, I was going to ask about Benny, actually, because I saw that you had played with him. And definitely, he's one that I really admire a lot.
Wonderful guy too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Stablemates. Yeah. Yeah. He's such a good composer, and I mean, he's everything. Yeah. Good guy. Great composer. Great player. Yeah.
Stable. Really wonderful. Classic. I think it really is.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you know you knew Dave McKay, right?
Oh sure. Yeah. I knew Dave.
Yeah.
I knew him in, you know, in L.A. when I was living in L.A.
Yeah.
Wonderful player.
Yeah, incredible. Mm-hmm. He was, I think, another person who was not as known as he should have been. You know, he was such a genius player.
He was a good singer, too.
Yeah, he was. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've been trying to get his some of his cohorts on the show, Mike and Lynn Palter. And but Mike's been a little under the weather, so they're back east now. But they played and sang with Dave. And they made a few recordings, and very nice, real great American songbook stuff, you know.
Yeah.
Dave was my friend forever. He was just the most lovely guy, and I actually traveled with him too. We mm-hmm. went to Japan and. I took him to the NAMM show and to the IAJE. Yeah. My girlfriend and I kind of shared the responsibility a little bit. We would see each other and we'd go, "Where's Dave? Who has Dave?"
He was super.
Yeah. Melissa is still with us, but she's not, you know, she's not what she was, but she's still with us, and she has a really nice she lives at home, and as Dave did too before he passed, and they have a really great caretaker, a man named Denver, who's just a sweetheart. And yeah, so it's a little heartbreaking to see her, because you know of what she was. She was so vibrant and beautiful, you know.
Well, Cathy, I don't know if you have a time constraint on these get-togethers, or?
Oh, you didn't know. I'm sorry. It's maybe you want to get off. It's two hours usually.
Two? Okay, I can manage that. I think.
Are you okay for another half hour? I mean, if not,
yeah, I wasn't sure. We never talked about it. I wasn't sure how much.
Oh. I'm so brazen, man. It's 2 hours of people's time. Usually it feels good though, because usually after 1 hour, that's when everybody feels like real comfortable, you know?
Yeah.
You worked with Sweets Edison too.
Yeah.
That must have been fun.
Yeah, he was something.
Yeah.
The Alpha and the Omega, as he used to announce.
Who was there anybody who was one of your like favorites or stood out for you as like
horn players, or just generally, or?
Just in general, like who you played with, or you played with so many, that must be a hard question. But
well, we talked about Frank Rosalino. Definitely Frank would be at the top of the list. And gosh, there's so many. John Guerin, of course. I kind of almost grew up with John Guerin, so I knew him. We were just kids trying to learn how to play in San Diego before either of us went to L.A. And of course, we talked about Shelley.
Yeah.
And Count.
Do you think Art Tatum was your biggest kind of mentor growing up?
Well, that's an interesting question. You know, he was on a radio show when I was a kid, before TV. I just had a radio, and he appeared on a show that's called Piano Playhouse. I think it was on Saturday mornings. It came on the radio, and so I would have been in maybe late grammar school, something like that, somewhere in there. And he used to be a guest on that from time to time. They'd have classical pianists and they'd have someone like Art, you know, not a lot of jazz, but definitely Art, because, you know, Art superimposed, if that's the word, on a classical quality in a jazz player is what I'm trying to. And I remember that I don't think I'd even started piano lessons yet. I did start piano at about 7 with a little neighborhood teacher, a woman, and that was my introduction to any kind of instruction. But I'm basically self-taught. I've never really studied with anyone. That was very brief when I was a really still a child.
Yeah.
But but anyway, Art Tatum, I could hear something there that it must have just been astounding. You know, I didn't know anything about composition or music or any theory. You know, I just was a kid.
Yeah. But,
and then over the years, of course, as I grew up and understood more about this music and its practitioners and all on various instruments, Art is just an Olympus of jazz music. You know, he was something else. I've always regretted, I didn't know at the time, about the time I left LA to move back to San Diego. That had to do with some family issues and things that I needed to be back in San Diego. And I've later, since then, learned that he was still living in Los Angeles. It's an area between LA and Hollywood, and I can't remember the name of the neighborhood specifically. You probably know.
It wasn't central LA or that kind of. No,
it was further north than that. It was, anyway, it was in that area. And he was still alive.
Wow.
At the very end of my stay in LA, and by the time I had moved back to San Diego, I had learned of his passing, but I didn't realize until later that he actually was still living in that house when he passed. My point being that I wish I had known and been able to go somehow to see him at the end. He may have been too sick at that point for anyone to visit anyway, but I've always thought that was, what a shame. I just absolutely worshiped Art Tatum, and everybody did. And to think that he was that close, you know, and I never, I think I, at the time, I thought he had lived in LA, but I thought maybe he had left to go maybe back to New York or something. I don't know, it's kind of a distant memory now, but anyway, he's, I mean, any pianist you talk to that understands anything about jazz piano will quote him as their god. You know.
Yeah. Did you get to see him live?
I saw him once live, actually, in San Diego. He appeared at a concert in San Diego playing solo piano. And I was in maybe junior high at that point, something like that. But I'd already listened to him on the radio so much that I knew this was something astounding, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. That's wild. Yeah, that's like the other day I was realizing that I think I might have seen Ella once live. But I grew up listening to her. I mean, my dad and I, you know, would, whatever we were doing around the house, we'd have the Ella records on and, you know, I mean, I just listened over and over and over again. So, but I only saw her live once, I think. That's kind of unbelievable, you know?
Well, yeah, woulda, shoulda, coulda.
Yeah,
Like with Art Tatum,
exactly.
I could have gone and knocked at his door. I wouldn't have. I may have gotten in, maybe not. I'm sure at that point, being cared for, you
Yeah.
know.
Was there anybody along the way that you, speaking of woulda, shoulda, coulda, that you wished, like looking back, is there anybody that you wished you had played with?
Just as part of a group or something, you mean?
Or yeah, just yeah.
Well, I mean, obvious names and figures come to mind. Lester Young, I mean, really going back, you know.
Yeah.
Heard, I met Diz once, just very, very briefly, but I never had any association with Dizzy. Zoot, I've worked with a lot, and since
Oh, he was an amazing player, you know.
he was unbelievable. Zoot.
One time I was listening to one of his records, and I don't know if it was just on this record or maybe one of his trademarks, but he took a brilliant solo and never used any what's the word? Oh my God, my brain. Never any motifs.
Oh,
Never. I mean, you
you
don't
mean
hear that.
like quotes that some
No,
people.
like repeated
Oh,
ideas, which
I
you know,
see.
like I mean, who doesn't do that in a solo?
Well,
Everybody does that in a solo, right? As a tool, I mean, or whatever. But this one solo, not one motif. And I thought, I couldn't believe I had heard it actually, you know, and it was a great solo. And I just thought, how is that even possible? And I wondered if that was a trademark of his, or if I just happened to hear one cut like that. Do you know about that?
I just always loved his playing. I'd be it'd be tough to come up with an example or something.
Yeah.
I know what you're saying. I understand what you mean. He didn't, as I remember, he didn't use quotes much, which a lot of guys do, you know,
Yeah.
especially earlier players, you know, his generation and even earlier.
Yeah.
Quotes are really common. And some people overdid them like crazy, you know, but
Yeah.
if they're the right one at the right time, it's, you know, it's wonderful.
Yeah.
And but he didn't, he rarely played quotes. It was all original melodies in his head, you know.
Which is amazing.
Yeah. I love Dexter Gordon, one of my
Yeah.
all-time favorites. But Dex played lots of quotes, you know. He'd fit the Star Spangled Banner into Laura, you know? But he had a way of doing it that it was just wonderful. And
Yeah. Yeah.
anybody else would probably would be terrible. But that's an ex that's the other extreme, you know.
Yeah.
Dexter was his style was largely based on quoting, but so brilliantly that you loved it. But Zoot really just made up his own melodies time and again, time and again. I don't remember ever hearing him much.
He was gorgeous. I'm sorry, I'm going to close my door because I have some people delivering a couch. So hold
Oh,
on one second.
okay.
My microphone is very sensitive, you know. So I don't want people to hear the couch man. Oh, good. There was a moment that allowed him to go away too. Maybe we can hear another song. Oh, there he is.
Sorry, I had to go to the door for a minute. My
That's
daughter
okay. I guess we both had to go to the door.
was.
Yeah, you're the art right behind, like straight back behind behind your head looks familiar to me. It looks like an artist that I used to have.
Behind me here?
Yeah, like right behind your ear on the wall. That might be.
Oh, you know what it is. You're not going to believe this. That's a drawing, kind of a painting that I did in high school. It may be worth a lot of money someday.
Well, yeah.
I can't point to it, but anyway, I know the one you mean. It's my left ear, right?
Yes.
Left ear. Yeah. Yeah. It's a little grouping of paintings I did in art class.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, I guess it's not a piece of art I have.
But thanks for the compliment.
So, yeah, there's a person, Lois Gilbert, and Louise Gilbert. Sorry, Louise. She's trying to ask a question about touring with SAS.
I think
hi, Todd Hunter says hi.
Todd Hunter. Oh yeah, I knew his dad very well. Bill Hunter was a wonderful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Todd's a friend of mine. I was just thinking about Todd this morning because I was listening to an incredible Brazilian guitarist singer named Philo, and who's he's going to be on the show, and he's amazing. And he and his grandson have done things for years. This beautiful little boy, the first thing they ever did together that I saw was Take Five. They were both playing guitar, and it was very up tempo, and some of it had been reharmonized. And Philo is a brilliant singer too. And his grandson had this little voice. I don't know, he must have been 8 or something, you know. They were both playing guitar. It was really amazing. But I was thinking of Todd because Todd last year, I think it was, went to Brazil and did a recording project, and really beautiful, and it was a great experience. And I just keep thinking, I think of Todd in Brazil having a great time, and he's such a great player and a really cool person.
I don't know if he still is, but for years he was, and I'm drawing a blank, it's a major, major name. He accompanied
Dionne Warwick.
Dionne Warwick, of course, and I couldn't place it. Is he still with her? I don't know. Is he?
Yeah, he still plays for her. And actually, she's on this record. She's singing One Cut.
Well, they've been together for years and years. He's been her accompanist. His father was a wonderful player. I loved him. He was older than me when we were both in San Diego. I was still living there. And his father was Bill. He was a great trad piano player.
Yeah.
I'm sure there were other things he could do too, but he could really play trad music, you know, piano.
That yeah. Era. Yeah. Todd's told me about, you know, how he grew up listening to him, because Todd also he's self-taught, and he listened to his dad and, you know, grew up.
Teacher.
Yeah.
His dad had a great left hand, you know, a stride piano, what they call it.
Yeah.
Really good at that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Todd is a really beautiful player. He's kind of, he's got that beautiful subtlety, you know, that is really kind of Bill Evans-ish, but in a modern, you know, approach, but really he's a beautiful player and writer and everything. Yeah.
You're in touch.
Yeah.
He called in, huh? You said?
He's on the chat here.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he told me, he said just before the pandemic was when he went to Brazil and recorded.
Okay.
Yeah. So what was I going to ask you? When I forget what I'm going to ask you, this is probably a good time to play a little something. So,
what have you got in your back pocket?
Yeah, man. Let's see. Well, this just makes me, it cracks me up. Oh, look at this. Wow, what came up? 1959.
Yeah, that's the group I was working with at that time. Johnny Guerin was the drummer. You can just kind of see in the background. And the trumpet player, as I mentioned earlier, Don Sleet. He died very young, unfortunately, in New York. But he was destined to be one of the serious trumpet players of his time. And
do you mind if we listen to at least a minute of this just for fun?
Of this recording?
Yeah.
Oh, you know, I guess not. It may be pretty rough. You know, this was...
I mean, let's just listen for a minute, just for, you know,
we were
for
all
fun.
Just kind of kids trying to figure it out.
Oh, Gary Lefebvre posted it. Wow. Wow.
Thank you.
To hear your solo. Well, that was a very cool arrangement, and that was over, was that a melody that was written over All the Things You Are?
I can't place what it was. Now it was a standard of some kind. I don't think it was All the Things, but boy, that's wild to hear that again. I have that. That was recorded by a guy on his you know, tape recorder in the club. We were playing in the club.
That's amazing, isn't it?
That was 19 or something like that. And I didn't even know it existed until just a couple of years ago. The guy or someone in his family mailed me a copy of the recording. And I have it somewhere. I mean, we were just kids trying to figure it out, but that's some fairly serious bebop.
Yeah, you were 20, right? Yeah.
If that, 19 or 20, somewhere in there, just before I moved to LA, I think. And, boy, it's wild to hear again. I can explain everything. But that was a great trumpet, as I said. And Gary Lefebvre, you apparently knew that.
Yes.
He was another wonderful player.
Yeah. I guess he posted that.
Could be, yeah, could be.
Yeah, it was under his name. Okay. Yeah. Somebody would like to hear you and Sarah, and I found this. Maybe you can kind of tell us what
we did with. As far as a recording, there was one with.
Here's
Joe Pass. It was just a quartet and her, but these are the trio concerts.
Yeah. Either one of these, I Hadn't Anyone, or I've Got the World.
Yeah, I Hadn't Anyone. That'd be good. Yeah.
Okay.
I was a lonely one. Tell you.
Sassy.
I used to lie awake and wonder if there could be someone in this wide world just meant for me.
That band is so there. Wow.
I used to lie awake and wonder if there could be someone in this wide world just meant for me. And I see I had to say.
Oh my God. Woo.
Yeah, that's Harold Jones on drums and Andy. Oh boy. Sass was something else, huh?
Something else, man. And then backed up by that trio.
Yeah, the guys.
Wow. That was something. God. Oh my God.
What's the big festival up in the Bay Area?
The Monterey Festival.
Thank you.
Yeah. Wow. You know, I remember one time I was listening to, I think it was Dave McKay and Andy Simpkins, and
yeah, they worked together a lot, I think.
Yeah, and it was, I always forget the drummer's name. He was a smaller black man, a very wiry, incredible drummer who I think he lives in San Francisco now. Anyway, when I got to town, they were playing together, and I literally fell off my chair listening to Andy Simpkins. I actually fell off my chair. Andy Simpkins was
something else. He was a good piano player as well, and he played those great bass lines harmonically, you know, that a pianist would typically play, a good pianist, you know, you can hear it in his bass lines, besides having wonderful time and all the other necessities, you know, but he really played harmonically. He played really interesting stuff. I think partly it had to do with his knowledge of the keyboard. You know.
That must have been so satisfying for you to play, to get in that space over and over and over again.
We had a wonderful time. That was 2 years I did with Sass, and boy, it was a wonderful experience.
You weren't like a solo artist going out there on tour and giving people your solo, your group, right? Not very much?
No. If you mean literally solo, I mean solo piano.
No, even with a group.
As a leader.
Did you put yourself out there as a leader a lot?
No, I never did enough because, you know, I got, I wish I had in hindsight. I wish I had. I didn't really know anything about promotion or getting it, you know, getting somebody behind you and, you know, an agent or someone that could kind of open some doors for you and all. And then I started getting so busy with recording.
Yeah.
As I got older, working in the studios, that I guess I just didn't feel the need to get out and self-promote like I kind of wish I had in hindsight, you know.
What were some of the things that you were doing in the studio?
In the studio? Well, I think as I mentioned earlier, some of it from the smallest little group of maybe a trio or a duo, backing a singer, for instance, or with horn players, whatever, and then all the way up to being part of a symphony orchestra. You know, we did an album with Sass of Michel Legrand's music that was, it's wonderful. You might want to check that out if you get a chance. I don't remember the exact title of the album, but it's Michel Legrand.
It'd be okay.
Fun. Yeah. And it was a full orchestra with harp and full brass and strings. It was a huge commitment, you know. It was an album that came out about 6 months later, I guess, or something like that. And so, you know, and I was just the pianist, me and Dave Grusin. Oh. Dave Grusin was the other pianist. That was before he was Dave Grusin. And they had two grand pianos on. I don't quite know why with all those other musicians. But it was a huge undertaking. I think it was United Artists, maybe was the label. Whatever it was, it must have cost them a bundle because it was a lot of mouths to feed. But it's all Michel Legrand, which of course you can't beat.
And yeah,
but you
I don't know about that time, but you arranged and conducted for a lot. It seemed like a lot of things in the studio, right?
Yeah, I did. I mean, a lot of times I was just a sideman. You know, I just
went
and open up a stack of music to see if I could read it. But sometimes I might be the leader, or you know, just depending on the situation.
Yeah. Boy, well, okay, now it's been about 2 hours, so I'm going to let you go. But I wanted to say thank you. It's really an honor speaking with you. I think so highly of you and your career and your music. It's just, you know, the effect that you've put out into the world is huge, and it's part of the underpinnings of our life, really. I mean, you just have contributed so much, so thank you.
Appreciate that very much, Cathy. Yeah.
Really appreciate it.
I'll try to live up to it.
Okay, see that you do. Because it is a process, you know. You never finish, you know.
It's been a wonderful get-together. I really enjoyed it. It's kind of nice to remember a lot of those things I hadn't thought about in years.
Yeah. Yeah. I prefer this kind of a hang rather than like just ask you your resume, you know. You know, I like to kind of talk about, you know, and it's nice to talk about all these people and remember everybody. And it's just such a, you know, it's such a huge part of our life, you know.
Both been very lucky, I would say. You know, a lot of it is, I mean, it's hard work and other things too, but a lot of it's just luck, happened in the right place at the right time and so on.
Yeah. Well, tomorrow, you guys, I'm going to have Jerry Watts on, who's a bass player, who's played with a lot of great people, including Flora Purim, Herbie Hancock, and he's very wonderful player, nice person. And then the rest of the week, we'll do archives with Katia Morris and Greg Perret and Ralph Humphrey and Jennifer Lightham. So, every day you can just sign on. And since Facebook won't let me do live right now, the live always goes to YouTube and the archives are on Facebook. So you can always go to Facebook and see. You can always find the link anywhere. So thank you again, Mike.
My pleasure, Kathy. It's been, you're a wonderful host.
Thank you. It's been a real pleasure. And since you're the 300th guest, you know, I'll have to think of a good prize for you. I know, there should be something, man.
A trophy or something.
Okay. Thank you so much. Have a great day.